Sonata.
You are listening to the Doug Stanhope Podcast.
The potato peelings in the sink did not turn into vodka as I had hoped. I only start to need a drink after the liquor stores have closed. I heard you change your name again, but don't you change your hair. It was the only thing I liked about you in the end. La, la, la.
Hey, you fucking jerk-offs. We are doing what I have coined a swapcast, and we've Googled that. No one else has used that. A swapcast is when two comics are doing a podcast. When you both have a podcast, you don't put it out as one or the other.
You swap it.
Swap. It is both. Swapcast. This is the Doug Stanhope Podcast.
Slash
and
Near the Wild.
With Matt Becker. The Near the Wild Podcast meets the Doug Stanhope Podcast in a head-to-head showdown.
So you guys are like swingers.
Yeah, kind of like swingers.
Or double-headed dildo.
Okay, yeah. All right. We have two guests on our podcasts, so it's like picking teams for kickball.
Yeah. Swapcast.
You get to pick first. Do you want Andy I have Brian Andrews Hennigan.
The first time Brian Hennigan's been on Near the Wild.
I mean, Brian Hennigan.
I've always wanted to be on Near the Wild.
This is great.
Yeah, and I got Andy Andrews as my guest.
Losers.
But we're going to
all right, we can't compete. Otherwise, the podcast will turn hefty.
This should turn into an obscene version of Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me.
Yeah. No, more likely, Wait, Wait, I've Heard Enough. Yeah.
Wait for it, yeah.
But we'll start with you because I don't even know the story. I just heard Hennigan or Chaley bring it up. Where you just went immediately irate. Like,
you know,
I
we're
do
two separate people. You know that.
What?
Me and Greg Chaley.
I know. One of you brought it up.
Yeah, okay. I'm just letting you know that.
Not on tour. We're the same.
I know.
A lot of people think these are my. I had to start referring to Hennigan as my business partner so you wouldn't get shit. Chaley is my tour manager. He's the guy that actually has to look the guy in the eye that you yell at the phone.
Well, most of them are asking for it.
And they don't even realize you don't have a Scottish accent. They're like, why are you such a dick to me? Like,
or they care that
no, that's Hennigan. That's not Chaley.
They don't even care that there's an inconsistency in the fact that he's Scottish.
The language, everything. But it's also kind of their fault for setting up their voicemail.
That's a callback to last week's podcast. That was 10 minutes
technology.
Ago. But someone brought up...
We're still in the plaza. Where are we?
Yeah. That we should be sponsored this entire podcast by Home Depot, and you fucking rip your hat off and go, don't, why do you fucking push
you
my,
fucking,
so Becker has a,
damn,
what's fucking, the fucking issue with
fucking,
Home
here's
Depot?
The deal, Home Depot, the fucking shittiest place in the world.
How angry are you?
We have three in the goddamn state of Alaska, okay? So they ship stuff up there, obviously, and I want two windows, they're fucking $38 windows, and they go, oh yeah, yeah, you can ship them to you, yeah. And then they send me an email back. No, we don't ship to Alaska. I go, what do you mean you don't ship to Alaska? You got fucking three stores here. We ship to all the other states, but not you. You don't ship windows to Alaska? Who doesn't
to your
need
own
windows?
Stores?
Yeah. I go, just throw them on the fucking truck. They go, we can't do that, sir. So then I have relatives out of state. They go, well, I can get them here, and then I'll ship them up to you. And then they, to add insult to injury, then they come and go, how was your experience at fucking Home Depot? And they're showing me the very windows they wouldn't fucking ship to me on Facebook. I go, how was my experience on your fucking video? You keep taunting me at the same windows you won't send me. So I fucking hate them. And then they breach fucking 60 million credit cards. Thanks, Home Depot. You're a pile of shit.
Do those Home Depot windows end up fitting well?
I never get them.
Have no choice.
I can buy.
Do you and Becky have to walk around inside with like scarves and mufflers on because there's no windows?
We have no windows. Right. No, we have old style windows. But I wanted these. These were like the old, like the old window ones with the slot glass. Yeah. They have the vintage ones. It's the only place you can get them. You can't find them anywhere else.
Like the apartment on Curzon.
So I wanted those two for our back because we can open them and let air in the string and crank them down in the winter. And they'd look great, bungalow style. That's our house. And God damn it, you can't get them. It's fucking ridiculous. I can go buy them right now in Las Vegas. But they won't let me take them as carry-on.
Why I started hating Home Depot was you go there and there's like you'd see a fat employee and you know how long those aisles are. So he's like 50 yards, but you see him and he sees you and he knows you got a question. And he's a fat fuck, but he moves pretty fucking fast. And they did, you know, where do they go? But they don't want to, they're like Disney characters. They fucking hit a corner and then they have a place where they just disappear.
I'm so bad at home repair that I don't even know, like, the nomenclature to tell them what I want. I need, like, a thing that does.
I bring the other one in, old one.
Yeah, but here's the deal is it's almost the point now. None of the people who work there want to work there. We're getting to that weird Peter principle where these people are going, I'm at Home Depot. I don't want this fucking job. I hate my job. What do you need? I go, I don't know. I couldn't find hammers. They go, yeah, they moved them. Where? I don't know.
I like when you go into Home Depot and they don't have it and you say, do you have any in back?
It's getting so you can't even find a checker to
Well, you know how
anymore.
Home Depot works is you have it now, but the guy didn't restock it, so it's on a pallet six stories up. Oh. You go, well, no, I can see it. You have them. Well, okay. Well, how long are you going to be here? That's always the first thing they ask you. Well, I guess until you can get something off six lights up.
See, I thought the Home Depot, when you get mad about it, I thought it was Costa Rica related.
No. This is fucking just living in America. They fucking
what's
have no
harder?
Problem
well,
selling
that's
shit.
The whole point. You're not living in America. You live in Alaska.
Yeah, and that's harder? The point. Because then why do I have to pay taxes in America, you fuck?
Becker built this house
might as well become
in Costa
Scotland.
Rica where you're like fucking Colonel Kurtz down there for fucking... I can't remember if we talked about this on the podcast or we're just talking about this. Anyway, you have a house you built in Costa Rica. Yes. What's harder to fucking get shit done, Costa Rica or Alaska?
Yeah, it's now Alaska. Alaska's become insane with fucking the problems they cause. I mean, you buy stuff, they return it. They won't take it back now. They're like, fucking Costco, I bought Copenhagen. I decided to quit chewing after 36 years. I take it back. They go, oh, I'm sorry, we can't take tobacco back. I go, why can't you take tobacco back? The Indians take tobacco back. Why can't you take tobacco back? And they're like, nope. I go, fuck you. It's the most expensive thing in your whole fucking store.
Charge
and the guy's like, I'm
card.
Sorry. We don't take tobacco back. I go, it's not open. It's the same way you gave it to me for fucking $70. And they go, sorry, go fuck yourself. So I said, I'm going to go in your store and break $70 worth of shit. The guy's like, what? I go, you watch me. And I did. I opened up bags of chips. I fucking flipped the flat screen.
You
fuck
pick
them.
Something up. You press your thumb through it. They can't see that on a security camera.
Yeah, no.
That's
you
more
know
what
you do?
Bread
Here's
a
great
way, but
fish line. Take fish line, you tie it around like a flat screen TV, and you tie it to the other aisle. Just wait for that lady with the car driving. Boom. Flat screen TV comes bumbling over. Bam. Guess what?
Yeah, you drive their prices up, and that makes the small businessman competitive again.
You know?
Because I have a flat screen from Jim's Flat Screens. Do you ever?
Yeah.
I want to find a partner that's good at the slip and fall. Because he, like, drops something, and then somebody comes down the aisle and does a slip and fall.
Oh, that would be our friend Steve Poggi with fucking six
Yeah, was Steve still here?
No, he's down in the lobby falling down. He's hammered already.
The original, a lot of the people who did the slip and fall were just in it for the money, but then it became, like, a drug thing. So, like, I wonder if that squeezed them out. Because so many
to get prescription
to get
drugs?
Pills, doing the slip and fall for, you know, it's like double reasons.
Well, the real problem with the slip and fall now is, you know what it is they got cameras so well and they're so
concentrated.
No, but they show video of the people laying down going, and they go, is this you? And they go, okay, I'm dropping my lawsuit. Can I go now? But it's really funny. There's a whole thing of them. You have people faking it. One guy puts dog food on top of his chest. He lays down, puts a bag of dog food like it tipped over, and he's like, and he's looking around going, and he starts going, like a turtle, and it's like, oh, are you hurt, sir? He goes, yes, I'm hurt very bad.
Again, con art is the only true art form to me.
Well, and
just good, if you're good at, and both of you, both Becker and Andrist are fantastic con artists, as is my manager, Brian Hennigan, the fact that I'm still doing comedy, he's probably the best con artist in the fucking world.
Smoke and mirrors.
Andy, fucking, you got to hear this story, Chailey. Andy shows up on Thursday. He's wearing a security guard's jacket. And someone made a joke about it. And
it's a, yeah,
turns
it's a,
out you were
Well, I got it at Goodwill, but it's like, you know, it's authority.
Wait. Let me back up a minute. When you worked with us in Arcata, you showed up with a huge I-5 sign from Interstate 5 somewhere in fucking Washington, right, or California.
No, it's just right near my house. I saw this downed I-5 sign. The north and south were bolted on.
It was
on.
Downed. You took it down.
No,
he keeps an orange reflective vest in his car, so he just stops on the side of the highway, puts on his vest, and starts unwrenching a giant I-5 sign because no one's going to question.
It was about noon, so I was kind of worried that people would think, what's he working into his lunch for?
Oh, yeah, that's true. Yeah, you're going, that's very rare.
So then I just took a break. I didn't have a cigarette, but I mean, I acted leisure like I was smoking.
Did people abuse you from their passing cars?
No.
Back to work.
I think everybody respects a orange vest standing on the side of the road doing nothing.
Yeah, he's driving like a 98 RAV4. That seems legitimate. But no, you see the orange vest, just assume.
It's got to be legal.
So nobody. Yeah, it's the perfect thing. Unless, you know, the guy who has the job.
That's really what Steve Porgy should wear all the time.
No, I was going to say, the reason they didn't catch him.
I think he had one that said inmate on back.
Yeah, I know. But they didn't catch him because they're too busy trying to round up Porgy in another state.
But I got, you know, it's like a thrift store find is like a security jacket because you, with a laminate and a security jacket, even if it's the wrong color security jacket, you can go, no, I'm actually security for the band.
It had the laminate?
No.
Oh, yeah, that's
carry
good.
Laminates, too, oh. With it on
I'm
back.
Not the venue security. I'm the band security. You mumbled through that, but that's
right.
Fucking brilliant.
Yeah. I'm with
you
with
tell
Lyle
the security you usurp their authority. I'm more security than your security,
yeah. I have to do my job because you don't do yours that well.
I'm going to have to ask you to leave.
We don't need
security.
To debate this now. I'm in a hurry.
I have moose for Lyle Lovett, and if I don't get it back there, things are going to go fucking bad in your life, man.
This thing could go sideways quick.
As you can just with a security jacket, you can just walk in places if you have, you know, hang on, I got to take this, you know, step back or whatever. But I went into, it was like a Michael Fronte, like a reggae-age concert, and I went to the bathroom and the door opened to a stall. And it was a classic hippie, skinny, fucking wearing the tie dye and the headband, everything.
In a toilet stall.
But he opened it up and he lit a joint. He lit a joint as he opened the door. He's gonna light it and walk out. And I'm standing there and he looks at me and I realize he's looking like, uh-oh, security.
And Andy says,
and I said, really, man, right in front of me. And he just hands the joint to me, and then I walked in the stall and closed it and smoked the joint.
But he showed up with that fucking I-5 sign. He's just like carrying it out of his car like you would, like, I'm going to a gig, I'm bringing my laptop. He's got an I-5 sign that he thought he could trade to hippies.
I needed merch. I needed merch, and I was in Humboldt, so I figured I could trade an I-5 sign for weed, but it didn't work out.
No. Too bad you couldn't find 420.
Well, Doug told, yeah.
Old Highway 420.
Those are all gone already.
It's like Route 666. They had to take it down because everyone kept stealing the signs.
Yeah. Doug told me, this guy's going to hook you up. So I was like, I was just, oh, cool. Then I don't even need to worry about it. And then he goes, no, we can't give you weed. And he gave me a thing to tie onto my pipe to snuff out if I had weed. Like, that's not hooked up. I don't know. Oh, yeah, and some little glass doodad, but that's not hooked up.
Okay. Don't look at me like you're going to wait for his story to actually end strong.
Or have
Let's
a point.
Let's move on to Brian Hennigan, your guy.
Yeah, it's your podcast.
I mean, we might sever this thing.
That's all right. Hey, don't worry. Every time there's dead air, I wrote down announcements like the biggest announcement of the year that everyone's been waiting for. Amy Bingo Bingaman is on Twitter finally. Go to @ Bingo Bingaman. If you can't figure it out, you're a fucking asshole.
How many tweets, Bingo? A
lot. How many followers?
Over 2,000.
That puts you in the top 10% of all Twitter.
Welcome to Random Thoughtville.
Wow. Chaley, @ Greg Chaley, Chaille, has, he had 1,100, and I go, I bet we can top you with Bingo in 2 hours. hey, everyone, follow. She fucking crushed you.
Yeah, that's because you said, hey, everyone, follow.
Yeah. Do I ever say, hey, everyone, follow Mr. Hennigan at Mr. Hennigan?
No.
No, because you're a rude person and you're a mean, you're a mean meanie.
Well, that's because they're all assholes.
Yeah. We'll cut that out.
Yeah. It's everyone.
No, I don't mind.
Pogey's back after several references to Steve Pogey from the last podcast.
Yeah. Hey, Pogey.
He doesn't appear to be either arrested or in hot pursuit.
I just want to say I like your style.
They process you quick at Las Vegas PD.
Yeah, I was going to say, I was surprised with Steve Pogey that, you know, given that all the stories were about, like, being fined or how broke he is, that he now chooses to live in San Francisco, the most expensive city in America.
That's exactly what I thought. I go, wow, you really overplayed your hand on that one.
I know. Must be one hell of an open mic.
He Pogey put out a book, Dummy's Guide to Local Jail.
County, wow, that County fell Logan? Flat right
wow,
there.
Wow, there you go.
No, but
again, I really think we're going to sever this thing. I think. Yeah. It's going to be an editing nightmare
it's
for you.
It's a trial, really. Yeah. That's what it is. This is really...
Trial. Yeah. This is this open mic podcast?
And by trial, he means Kafkaesque. Oh! Tracy Werner got that joke. Yeah, she's literary, you know.
Andy, somehow.
Yes?
Anytime something weird and fucked up happens, like, why is that person in our room... How did they even know our room number?
Oh, Andy.
So I had forgotten all about this. The other night, that a girl that came to the show that evidently works in the ER here in Vegas showed up, and it's way early hours of the morning, just fucking wrecked, slobbers into the room, spills over everyone. She was like, late... Laying on you in front of Becky.
Yeah, it was
not
like,
a good move.
No, you're going to end up in the ER.
You told her that. You go, you sit on my lap one more time. You're going to need to be in the ER. Because she kept saying, I have to be at the ER
at 9 in the morning.
Yeah,
and we're looking
or...
7.
She said, it's 30 minutes to drive home. I'm like, you could probably crash with Andy, who probably is the guy that gave you our room number. And then
I don't know. No, I can't. I don't know where she came from.
I have no idea. She just
I did
walked
not know
in
her
here.
Before you guys put her in my room, and then we got to know each other later.
Yeah.
Oh wait, but wait. Go ahead.
You didn't know her before you said follow me.
I did not put her in my room. You guys
Andy.
Set me up.
Yeah, we set you up that night. But what did you just tell me right before we hit record? Hey, I think that ER nurse is coming back tonight.
She has my phone number.
Well, oh, she has your phone number.
Well, at least
so
you
that
found
means
your
I
phone.
Invited her.
No, she's not. She's not coming here.
Say it again, Becker. I stepped on
well,
you.
Well, at least you found your phone.
I know. Yeah,
that's the best.
That's the
2 days
thing.
Of driving Louis Anderson's scooter around. I'm going back here to find my phone, but the scooter still works.
What was I doing again?
You know what goes good on a Louis Anderson scooter? A Slim Fast shake. Delicious.
Always sign the pump.
Yeah.
So evidently we have the Swedish reggae guy and the ER nurse. Oh, you think this podcast is going clunkingly? Wait till you have her talking to the Swedish reggae guy.
She sent me a message and said that she got slammed at work, which means she showed up a fucking wreck and then had like multiple fucking injuries.
Well, I told her, I said, I talked to her, and I said, you can go to work like this? She goes, I'll just do an IV, a B12 IV, and it pulls you up.
Oh. Was someone at football on Sunday, that fat, weird cartoon guy who looked
like
the comic book guy from The Simpsons.
What do you mean, that guy?
Justin. Yeah, he's big, fat face, long hair with a squeaky, nasally voice. He goes, you know that ER girl that I guess she say, slept in one of your rooms? Yeah, I talked to her. She said we can all go over. If you want to get rehydrated, they can just like hit you up with an IV.
Yeah, he goes, but you got to have insurance cards. And I go, what? She's cold calling for the ER? hey, check the book. Is there a coupon?
A lot of emergencies can be prevented by just showing up at the ER. I anticipate a heart attack.
Well, the thing is,
I
thought with her, I bet she's getting promoted to the coroner's office because so many people are dying on her shift. They'll just move around. You're better at catching.
He's gonna be a natural.
You're better at catching than receiving.
After being hit in the head with a bottle, the last thing you want to see is an ER nurse from Andrus's room showing up to sew you back together.
You know where I could get a bump? If you got hit in the head by a bottle, you must know.
Andy said he'd call.
Oh, I like you know, most guys I date never come back, but you seem like you'll show up at work a lot.
You're the only second offender I've ever encountered. Repeat offender.
All else
That's
failed.
The name of my podcast, Repeat Offender, and we're live with Repeat Offender. My guess is Derek and a donut.
No, you know, we own the subcast genre. You can't do that.
Yeah. Swapcast.
No,
he's subcast.
He's subcast. All right.
Leechcast.
Leechcast.
I Googled it. That actually exists.
Yeah, I bet Bumcast is out there.
I always, all else fails, I always go to Andy's torturing his neighbor stories.
Oh, yeah. I must have told the one about the guy who I ruined his life.
The litterer. That was
Doug Stanhope.
Not the. No, okay.
And it wasn't his life, it was his career, but keep going.
Some of the credit belongs to everybody in this room in some small way. I think we've all paid a part in this. Wait, this is my speech for his funeral.
You're not getting invited.
I'm going to get Johnny Depp at Doug's funeral. Johnny Depp.
You're going to be unpersoned like Stalin did. We'll be removing you from the photographs.
Me and Marilyn Manson in a tent and back on a big screen, the only two people in the room.
He'll leave as soon as he finds out there's no open bar.
Okay, but so I had a neighbor who's he overflow parking in our driveway. It's a van. It's creepy. I didn't like him. And one time he was out there, and I go, "Would you move your van in as nice a way as I could?" And he said, "Fuck you."
He actually used the F "fuck you."
He said, "Fuck you." Yeah, like fuck, that's it. Like I mean, that's
Eugene, Oregon. That's not the type of person. He said they were
tweakers or whatever, and I was suspicious. It was a marijuana grow place when this guy was down there. And then, so he said, fuck you, and that was the end of the conversation, and then I immediately started plotting somehow to fucking ruin his life. But he just brought it on himself. I live in the steep hills of South Eugene, Wisconsin. And we got wild turkeys in Wisconsin, and so I'm driving up my hill, and I see what looks like a wounded turkey in the road. And as I get closer, I see it's a guy, and his legs are kicking, and he's got a head wound. He rode his bike down and went over the handlebars, landed directly on his rude head. Because I started to take my shirt off, seeing a guy with a leaky head wound, and I'm the first responder. And
that'd be like somebody thinking, how can this get worse?
Yeah, no, and it got like, real worse because
you show up
because I look over him and I could see through the blood and everything. It's the guy who said "fuck you," and so I didn't put my shirt under his head, nor did I do anything. And I waited, and it was like 10 minutes before somebody else stopped and offered comfort. And I just stood over him and go, you know, it's up, man, or whatever, you know. I'm not going to help you or whatever.
Remember me?
Are you ready to move your van now?
Yeah. Hey, man, if you pass out, are the keys in your pocket? I guess I'll find out. But he was, you know, holding on to, like, consciousness or whatever. And then the paramedics eventually show up because somebody else called 911. It wasn't me.
Did you know any of them?
The paramedics, I hadn't seen their work, but I've heard about both of them.
Did they park in the drive?
Well, so he was laying there, and he was coherent enough to be able to talk to the paramedics, but he played dumb, didn't want them to know where he lived or anything. And I was like, I'm Johnny Helpful or whatever. And then I was like, hey, man, I'm going to take your bike up there and show the paramedics where you live if there's anything else you need or whatever. And he got, they loaded him up. And then I still thought it was a meth place, so I had I knocked on some doors and nobody answered, so I did a Steve, I burglarized the place, But I just went in.
Andy knows a lot about his neighbors by just going into their house when they're at work.
Right. Well, yeah.
But you don't know this in the story till he's just.
There's some of it I can't talk
about. This weird lady, and I know she smokes weed because I was going through her medicine cabinet. Like, why were you in her medicine cabinet? Well, I know she leaves the bottom door unlocked, and like, that's not even the part of the story.
I know she had a lot of anxiety. So anyway, like I went through this guy's house and he didn't have much to take, but it was an indoor grow.
You'd already taken his dignity.
Right. And I gave him away to the paramedics who probably sent him a bill. But there was just enough, there was like an ounce of weed all packed. So I took that because I carried his bike up the hill and helped him with the paramedic situation. And I took that weed, and then about a week, not even that, like 3 days later, I hear a ruckus and like, fuck you, you pussy, put the knife down, you rattling in the door. And I went out and I dialed 911, and then I realized, oh, it's that guy, it's Dave again. And this guy's threatening to kill him and kicking at the door. And then I went and smoked some of his weed, let the situation cool down a while.
Because you're anxious.
Yeah, it did make me anxious, so I had to go into the other neighbors to get a couple of her Xanax. I'm like the neighborhood watch you don't put up signs for.
So are you the only one in your neighborhood doesn't work?
I guess.
It's a full-time job being neighborhood watch.
Yeah, that's it. Not for long.
It's a humble living, but it's very rewarding. Oh, so anyway, but Augie, this guy, the last I saw him, he was walking down the hill urgently. And
Well, you took his bike.
His bike, yeah, well, his bike was fucked up, locked up. When I took his bike, I could tell the front wheel completely locked up, so that's how I knew he went right over on his noggin. But so then I was telling the story to Augie Smith, and he goes, well, probably the guy was threatening to kill him because you took the weed. And it's like, oh, yeah, probably. And then I thought, well, he should have moved the van. That would have saved all of it. So his van moved, somebody else, it was gone, and I don't know that he didn't get murdered, but yeah.
So are you basically saying you see your role in people's lives as some sort of karma?
Kind of an angel.
Uh-huh.
Because I could have been, like, if it was a different dude, he didn't have his van in my driveway, I would have put my shirt under his head, and, I still would have robbed his house.
You're like a black swan in your neighborhood. Yeah. You just kind of, you're a domino that knocks everyone else down.
I am a reflection.
See, I thought you were referring to Black Swan in terms of Nassim Taleb's book about financial deregulation. I thought it was a very funny thing to say.
It was, but I figured we had to dummy it down because it's a shared podcast.
Becker, can you tell any of your neighbor stories? You've had some horror show fucking
no, because they move, we don't.
Yeah, Becker, you're a good fucking bouncer of neighbors.
Yeah, I just
you even bounced Chaley out of fucking Alaska.
But the new guy's great. He's a divorce lawyer who moved into the house, and he's very nice.
Becky's not here, is she?
No.
Oh, you can't say, oh, it's great. I got a divorce lawyer finally.
No, I know. You just assume how good he is now that he's renting the house next door.
lawyer? I don't think so.
You know any good divorce attorneys? Notice you just moved in.
Yeah. You just
got to
hit a deer.
It's shit in one box.
No, I wouldn't think of using you. You're a neighbor and you live in a shithole.
No.
I think that's one thing we all have in common is plotting against people we hate and never getting around to actually doing it.
But putting real detail into it.
Yeah. You just sit and fantasize all day. Oh,
it really lifts you out of depression to start plotting crimes.
The Annoyatron, this podcast brought to you by the Annoyatron, which is a little bug thing that's on a magnet. It's a little tiny thing, and we have metal fences, so if any fucking creepy people move in next door to us, we had one fucking really sketchy guy, and drug people, they're aware of very tiny sounds, and the Annoyatron will every 15, 20 minutes go, and then not again.
And
someone's like, what was that? I'm a tweaker. What was that?
Yeah.
And the metal fence amplifies it. So it's just a little magnet right by their fucking bedroom windows along our fence.
You know what you need to do is...
They're available through thinkgeek.com.
You've seen them.
I just go through Amazon, but Amazon. I go through Bill Burr's link. Go to Bill Burr Bill and Burr. Then click on Amazon. Phil Hendry. That's the guy. You go to philhendry.com and then click on the Amazon link, and he gets money. Listen to Phil Hendry. Over 5,000 hours of archived of the best, funniest radio fucking shit ever. Yeah, there you go. Phil Hendry and Annoyatron.
That's what
get
I
rid of the tweakers with Annoyatron.
Have you heard of, you've seen the speakers that look like rocks?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, yes. That would be perfect. Like if it was tweakers or whatever, you could just go, we're getting ready to arrest these, whatever you do, just to completely scare the shit out of them.
Well, the Annoyatron 2 does cell phone rings. Just randomly, just old-fashioned. So those are great to put, like, in a movie theater under a seat. So it's randomly, everyone's looking at one guy like, fucking turn off your cell phone, dick. Like, there's a million places for that. Hennigan, you found, and it was wicked illegal, and it didn't, it worked once, and then it
was probably a friend of mine. Keep going.
Was it me?
A cell phone jammer.
Jammer. I know. I tried to buy one in England. You can buy them in England, and they won't ship them to the U.S.
So. I know. That's right. Well, they won't ship them to the U.S. So, but if we did get
one. He got one. You got it from China, right?
I can't remember where.
It only worked once, and then it shit the bed.
It was good, but the problem was that the battery pack wasn't very effective, so you had to keep it plugged into the wall. So it was okay in like a cafe or something, but
On planes it was the fucking greatest. I was just so waiting to get on a flight just so everyone's like, we're just sitting,
we're getting
yelling
ready to
conversation.
Land.
We're about to take off. Yeah. No, hang on, I can keep going. They're not closing the door yet.
It's not working anymore. What's going on? I have no. Hey,
does this flight have waffles?
Sorry, that's Andy's recurring Louis Anderson callback.
I like waffles.
Hang on. I want to hear about.
So cell phone jammers. The whole point about cell phone jammers. They won't have them in the U.S. and they're obviously for emergency numbers. But they go, why can't we have them in prisons? They keep having problems with people with cell phones in prison. And they go, well, in case the staff needs to make a call. What, to the guy bringing more cell phones? Mm-hmm. Who the fuck? Why can't you jam them there?
But there was some guy that was arrested in Florida recently who was driving around with a car-sized cell phone jammer just to stop people making calls. He'd been doing it for like 5 years, and they couldn't work out what the hell was going on. Like, vast areas would suddenly be without cell phone service. He was just driving around this town like a dick, stopping him.
It's not like you can call the cops.
For the listener, whatever you know about cell phone jamming equipment, please email doug@dougstanhope.com. Let us know what you know, because I fucking love that. And the battery was a piece of shit.
Illegal. Yeah, they're highly illegal now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This was actually shaped
it's getting
in a
to be like
Marlboro
spice.
Cigarette
That's
pack.
Right. It was shaped like a cigarette pack.
What happened to the TV away?
Oh, TV be gone. We're always sponsored by them. I have one in my bag. I don't travel without it. I'm not fucking, no, Nancy Grace doesn't exist in my airport.
I wonder if it worked turning off the big TVs in front of the casinos.
I like the fact that
I don't think they work by remote.
I like the fact that they use like medieval spell formula for the name TV Be Gone, as opposed to TV Away. Yeah. It's just TV Be Gone.
Be gone with you.
We banish you.
Hang on, I have to tweet my girlfriend at Bingo Bingaman. To see if I could get another cocktail. Cocktails.
Cocktails.
She's my best follow ever, and I'm not. Bingo on the new. She's hilarious.
All right, we're gonna take a quick break for cocktails.
Cocktails.
Andy, you keep going with your story.
don't let the mic being off stop you.
I like whipped cream on my waffles, and they brought them down, and it's just very cold.
Hey, we're gonna take a quick break for a cocktail. This break is brought to you by theshadydell.com. In Bisbee, Arizona, come down, stay at the Dell, stay with the stars.
The only time waking up in a trailer is a good thing.
TheShadyDell.com. That is where you stay. If you come to Bisbee and you're staying at the Shady Dell and I'm in town, I will have a beer with you. I won't hang out that long. We're not going to be good friends. I don't want you to fucking tell me you're going to kill yourself. But if you're staying at the ShadyDell.com, Vintage Trailer Park with all 50s, 60s trailers that we live a mile away from, and we look for reasons to go stay there. Come to theshadydell.com. Sponsored by. I might even come in and clean your toilet. I don't know. All right, Australia, New Zealand, we're coming. November 11th, we start in Brisbane. Actually, don't we have another? Was that a secret date in
We're going to go to Byron Bay.
Byron Bay, we're going to start out. And then Brisbane, we got Canberra, we have Sydney, Adelaide, Perth, Melbourne. Sorry, Darwin, I tried my best. And soon we will be adding Auckland, New Zealand to end it all. Not to end it all. I have other plans for that, but okay, now back to the podcast, already in progress. All right, we're back with the Swapcast, the Doug Stanhope podcast, and the
Near the Wild podcast with Brian Hennigan.
Yes. Yeah, and I think we're winning this round.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. We're going to go on to the final.
Yeah, this is not going to be a decision.
Andy had the fucking greatest line at the end of the last podcast. Of course, as soon as we go, that's the end of the podcast, Andy goes with a brilliant line. But someone came up to you and said that you look like shit. Or
Oh, yeah. Like, yeah, he just walks up. And I was supposed to do his podcast, but he walked up and he goes, "Hey, Andy Andrus." I go, "Yeah." And he goes, "Wow, you look like shit." And I, how do you know what I'm supposed to look like? You know, like maybe the picture, maybe my 8x10s tell a few lies. Not that I have 8x10s.
People do say, they email you and say, "Hey, can you send me an autographed 8x10? Like, no one has 8x10s anymore. No. It's all fucking online.
Yeah, Jackie Mason.
Don't care how much cancer you have. You're not getting an 8x10.
Should we let Steve Poggi jump in? He says he has a unflattering Louis Anderson story.
Oh, yeah. This is a kid who can't find work.
Yeah.
I told him he's still young and cute enough you could get booked with Louis Anderson.
Once I get off probation. But, yeah, he was doing a club that didn't have a green room. They just had, like, an office area, and he was in there.
That's the only clubs we do.
And as he's performing, there was an assistant with him. A young, strapping young lad. And every time the manager went in...
Probably stolen from Barry Sobel.
And every time the manager went in there...
Poacher.
Be like, "Oh, Louis, you have 5 minutes." He would open the door and he would always hear, "Rub my feet better. My feet are being rubbed right."
"Who's got wall balls? Why is my motor scooter wet?" I try not to trash other comics, but
oh, no.
Yeah, Louis Anderson seems like he's crest,
right?
Yeah, he can take a beating.
He's like Ron White that just wants gay stuff.
What?
Well, Ron White's huge, and you know, everybody will do what he wants around him. It's just that Louis wants his feet rubbed by a boy.
Yeah,
nothing
under
wrong
the
with
age
you
of
know.
13. Just you know when they're ripe.
That's why you work hard in this business. You can have your
all right, back after that break.
All right. Is it on? Okay, good. We can start.
Cocktail hours.
Matt, how many listeners can you afford to lose?
I don't know that we're going to be sharing this as much as you think.
Like, what's your demographic on After the Wild?
Well, you know, After the Wild?
Yeah.
I mean, at post-haste.
Yeah. Near the Wild podcast.
Oh, Near the Wild.
Yeah.
What's your demographic?
Well, it's all pretty much 32-year-olds.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, all 32.
They drop in.
Well, like, race horses?
In Alaska. He just, all the people that were blacked out at the bar, he has to retell the stories on his podcast so everyone that goes to the bar goes, "Oh, that's how it happened."
Okay, now I get it. Yeah. No. Oh, and I did magic. That's after the show. The Sunday.
Oh, yeah. You were doing fucking table magic.
So here's the joke is that I came in on Saturday. We flew in for the show and had to go directly to the hotel and ding. And then had some cocktails and did the show and it went swimmingly. And then Sunday is football. Of course, we got drunk. And I don't have any playing cards because I don't bring playing cards to Las Vegas. They have them. It's bringing cocaine to Columbia. You don't need to. But I couldn't find the gift shop. People kept giving me bad directions, so I'm running around trying to find fucking cards because I just need a deck of cards from the casino. And so I finally find them. And I go, okay, I'll do this. So I go over. And so I start doing it just for a couple people. And then the other people are going, hey, you got to do that. And I love it when they do that. You have to. I go, no, I really don't. But okay.
I put you on the spot, and I hated to.
Huh.
But there was two people at the bar during football at the sports book, and they were bitching about the show. Everyone was bitching about the liquor service. Yes. Wasn't my fault.
Right. Yeah.
There was fucking 450 people and three bartenders. Right. At a Doug Stanhope show, it should almost be 1-to-1 bartender to drinker. Yeah. Yeah. So this nice couple, and they're not like being dicks about it, but they're kind of bitching about the whole...
Like, that's your fault.
Hey, yeah. We waited for an hour, and then, you know, I missed the half the opening acts waiting for the drink. And I go, Becker's right over there. And I go, oh, wait, I explained who you and Andy are. These are like two of the funniest people I know. Just I go, and I started to try to explain what you do at your bar in Anchorage, which you have to fucking see.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to explain that. And I just stopped and I said, fuck it, Becker, come be entertaining. And like that, you came over, you whip out shit, you're balancing a dollar bill on its end on your nose. You got card tricks. You have fucking magic and dumb shit. And I finally left. Like,
You're good. You guys are good. Yeah. And they could get beers away, right at the bar.
Your show's going on, huh? I got to watch football here. Yeah, you get a whole hour of Becker. And they were thrilled.
But what's fun, and I always forget this, is the same with Costa Rica. Doing magic is one of those things where, you know, whatever. But what I do is, like, in a casino, when you're doing card tricks, when they just lost their life savings at blackjack, and then I take a playing card, make it disappear, and show up right in front of them, they go, I think I got robbed over at the table. They go, fuck yeah, you did.
I was worried about that last night when we were playing cards. I'm like, Becker's been doing card tricks all up and down this fucking casino. Are we going to get, like, shut off at the blackjack table? Because... He's very good.
Yeah,
and I fucking hate magic. But
I know you hate magic. That's what I was going to ask. You hate magic.
I do, but he's not a douchebag. He's hilarious. As he's wearing a plastic suit coat that's made out of shower curtain material. And just as he's like riffing, just bam, bam, jokes and card tricks. And just, but someone like walks by and says, yeah, that's a good raincoat too, as well as a sport coat. It's good. It's vomit proof too. If someone vomits, it's just immediately every fucking line he's nailing. And I just pulled him up from the bar out of a hangover. We're just both slouch-eyed walking out of the fucking room to go hang out with fans, which I thought was going to be a good idea. Then I go, oh, it's going to be a bad idea. It turned out good.
It turned out to be a great
idea. But you were just fucking nailing it.
Oh, it was a blast.
You go, yeah, that's the opening act you missed while you're waiting for one of three bartenders to give you a fucking warm beer.
The best was, at first he pulled up a stool from the sports book, and like in a corridor, he was doing a magic to about six people, right? And I go take a piss. I come back. He has a street, like Fremont Street circle around him.
Like a busker.
And he's doing it, right? And then he gets done with his show. I'm surprised he didn't fucking have a hat passing around, right? Because he had
have to check in 2 weeks in advance, because if you're going to pass a hat, yeah, the house gets
no hat.
Need to know what's
so
going
I just
on.
Start picking wallets.
Las Vegas entertainment. Yeah. Yeah. Becky's around. Yeah, keep going, honey. Keep going.
You got it.
This is a big crowd. I got to make the rounds. So he gets done with that, and he comes over to where I'm drinking with a couple other people, and someone says something about magic, and there's not a chair around, and he throws the fucking cards right on the floor, and he's doing floor magic, and he sets it down, he does this thing, and then he has the deck, and he goes, we put here, and then we put this one on top, and then he takes the deck and slams it down, and all the cards fly, and then one flies to the side, and it's the fucking four of hearts, the one the guy picked. I'm like, on the four.
Yeah, but it looks so random, because it's just like you throw the deck, I guess he's not doing the trick. And then it goes, flip, 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 flip. And everyone's like, that's pretty good.
It's fucking fantastic. Yeah, no, it was a great day.
Our friend Mr. Dunwoody in Bisbee. Becker was down there. The Beckers were there for Thanksgiving, and... Becker does some trick. Fortuitous with a red light that you happen to have the thing anyway. I don't know how it worked. But then one trick where he throws the deck of cards at the window, closed a window that doesn't open, and the card the guy picked is Mr. Dunwoody is on the other side. And they went, him and Mr. Dunwoody and another lady
were doing like a forensic science thing for like an hour. Like the party's gone on, everyone's in there still looking around the kitchen like, how did this possibly work? Fucking cold case files.
Tape on the windows.
Fingerprints.
Dexter lines
DNA.
Going through the room.
Yeah, but these are the same people that when you got your flat screen TVs delivered from out of state were going around the back of them trying to see where the pictures were coming from.
Okay. Well, that's not the most flattering compliment then. All right. How'd you get the stuffing in the turkey? This is ridiculous.
It's the Arthur C. Clarke thing about any technology you don't understand appears like magic.
Yeah. Well, Becker,
it's like the elevator for Andy.
Yeah, exactly.
I go in one room, I wake up in another.
This floor is the same but different.
Becker, well, you started doing this shit at some. I don't know if the people know how Costa Rica is, but it's pretty fucking beautiful, but third world. Yeah. So some of those Tico bars you go into, and you went to a place by the house down there,
yeah, the round,
and started doing it like with kids and Ticos. And they looked at you like you're some fucking black wizard shaman.
Don't do this in Haiti, by the way.
No, but
I'm amazed they don't have people bringing their children.
No, they did. I said it was almost like that because the first year I did it, it was like, oh, it's funny. They go, Magic Man, yeah, great. And we went to this like outdoor party thing one night. They got invited to this local party where they had a local band, and they treated us wonderful. They were great, amazing people. But at the end, there were like 40 people standing there. And our friend that we go through, Mario, a good guy that we've known since we moved down there, and he goes, I go, what are they doing? He goes, they're waiting for you to do magic, but they didn't want to be rude and interrupt you. And I'm like, I'm now drunk at a house party. Going, oh, all right. So I go and do it. And it comes off as well as it can because, again, they have no idea how you – their world is just you can't do that. You know, they get a lot of it, but they don't get how you even do that. I go, you have nothing but time down here. Get a deck of cards.
His legs are lame. Yeah. Please. No, that's I can't. Is this your card? Oh, every time Chili doesn't have a microphone, he has the best line.
Is your card?
Yeah, so it's very scary because, yeah, they want to build a church or burn
it. Has anybody ever, like got a grip? No, some people be dicks about magic and try to fuck you over.
No, see, I take all that out of it. I have angles on all of it. I mean, like, they'll go, that's not my card. I go, 100%, I don't make mistakes. I mean, I'm that flawless where
it to them hard? Like, no, that is your card.
I have a series of tricks where they, like, I have one where it ends up in a Red Bull can sitting right in front of them. Uh-huh. And they pick the card, they're going to do the whole thing. Well, at the very end of the trick, there's a card underneath the Red Bull can. Uh-huh. And so they go, that's your card. And they turn over. And any dick in the crowd, this is usually the closing thing for them, they'll go, oh, and they turn over, it's not the right card. And they go, ha, you're wrong. And every jackass that was being like low level, you know, they jump on it. And you fucked up. And I go, oh, wait, hang on. And I cut the Red Bull can open, pull out the card. There it is. And then they go, oh, fuck.
Just hearing that story makes me feel good.
No.
It's like I feel all from that.
But that's why I built it. I built all of it like that, where I go, you weren't going to figure it out. Even if I told you I did it, you'd still go, well, yeah, still you're not going to see it.
Becker, when we were first starting out in Phoenix, I was opening one time at Knuckleheads in Phoenix with a magician was a headliner. And Becker just sit in the back of the room with me and go, oh, no, what he does, he's going to put the thing in the fucking orange. And he just... midway through the week, I'm like, yeah, my buddy was explaining to me how you do that thing with the orange, and that's where the other half of the dollar bill. And he's like, who told you? There's a code. There's a code. You don't tell.
I've got hypnotist stories. I collect
Steve Poggi.
Steve Poggi back. Two bad hypnotist stories. One is if you see any kind of hypnotist, they'll use like a code word or a phrase, and that's where the whole audience or the people on stage are supposed to act asleep. And this one hypnotist, he was doing like the you're the audience police. If anybody laughs, you gotta get them to stop. And so he'd say something, they'd start laughing. It's this little old frail woman. She's like, oh, you gotta stop it right now. Don't laugh anymore. That's enough. And then, you know, they laugh more because of that. And she, no, I'm being really serious.
And then they laugh even harder. And then she rushes to the front to this two couple. And she says, shut the fuck up, you niggers. And he's Iceberg, Denny's, shut it down. Like he can't say the right thing fast enough. They're fucking hitting him down. Oh, I'm a sheep now. I'm
here. Oh, my God.
If your second hypnotist story is not that strong,
yeah,
I'd
don't
skip
tell
it.
Yeah.
This one's good from the like industry. Aspect.
You don't end all up right. rubbing Louis Anderson's feet, do you?
No. Rub him again.
No, that's
rub him again.
That's yet to come.
Work the bunion, please. Oh, no.
Work the bunion.
I gotta sit on that scooter for an hour.
He's not come all this
I
way.
I found a cell phone. Some drunk guy with a lot of missed calls. What you got?
Go ahead.
The second end of this story is there's this club, and they're pitching the triple X-rated hypnotist show of all you see the dirty extra thing.
I thought they all were at this point. All dirty hypnotists.
They'll do like an early show. You need to bring the kids so we can really sell tickets.
Triple X-rated. Ass to mouth? Really?
Really?
Is this a hypnotist show with ass to mouth?
Triple X-rated hypnotist show. Last
DP
minute.
DP hypnotist show.
Last minute, hypnotist cancels. Club owner goes to the phone book, fucking flips open hypnotist, finds a guy, calls him up. Comic opening for him. He's the one that told me the story. The hypnotist comes out, and he's doing, like, the classic hypnotist, like, these napkins are money, and you want to get as much money as you can. And then after the first show, the booker
Neil
comes
Hamburger?
In. The booker comes in irate. This is a dirty hypnotist show. These people are told it's going to be dirty. You have to be out there and be dirty, or you're fired. And so the fucking hypnotist, and the comic's like, you got to go be dirty, man. What do you want me to say? But instead of being dirty, he comes out and he's like, all right, you fucking cunts. These napkins are fucking money. You want to get as many of these bitches as your fat fuckhead face will carry. And he's just cussing at him and not doing dirty bits. He gets fired the next show.
I like that. I like that.
So, yeah, if you have any bad hypnotist stories, please send them to me. I love them.
I don't know where we go from here.
That's it.
But what time are we at, Chili?
I'm not sure we've been picked up for distribution yet by the After the Wild podcast yet.
Near the
Wild.
Near the Wild.
Yeah.
Is this? You know, you would understand the podcast if you'd ever been to Becker's house, but you've not been to Becker's house.
Never got the invite.
You're always invited.
Invite you.
Yeah. But in fairness, I was only there in Alaska once with Julie, my ex.
Yeah. So. It was a quick trip.
I thought you
he
were
sat
to
at the birdhouse.
Out.
Yeah, he was at the birdhouse, had a cocktail.
Yeah.
That's the thing about the birdhouse with back to Becker with magic, is that he's in a U-shaped bar. He's doing magic with people behind him.
Yeah.
Wait. First of all, Becker is funny when he's doing magic. So even if you hate magic, he's still hilarious. He doesn't try to be like an illusionist like that. What's that cunt, the Maldonado effect?
Oh, my God. You told me about that, right?
Carbonaro?
Let's not even don't spell it right.
No, because, you told me.
Maldonaro, and then you can't Google it.
He is so fucking ridiculously fake, it's ridiculous. The whole thing was it breaking the car windows out. Oh, you have an extra one in there? And you go, you're right. A guy in L.A. would leave his car with the keys in it when he goes in the store, and you come out and break his window, and somehow you're able to roll electric window up before he gets in his car. Yeah. I go, this is so set up, it's ridiculous. And the one gang member is like, hey, you broke my window, man. I don't have that kind of money. I'm like, really? Go break a window. And you carbonaro effect. Yeah. It's called shit. That's what the carbonaro effect is.
Yeah.
But when Hennigan was asking about
look, I'm going to magically disappear from this closet and then come out of it. That's what you should do. Sorry.
Hennigan was asking, Becker has the best training ground for figuring out angles because they're drunk. He's doing it for people that are in the bar or worse than that, bachelorette parties or people coming in for free drinks or whatever they do, you know, on my birthday or whatever. He's entertaining them and making them stay longer. And then the room resets every 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And I've sat there for an entire
shift. Well, Chilco Charlie's has 12 bars under one roof. So people just do the lap.
Somebody wants
no one's going to fuck me in here.
Okay. do you have a rival? Is there another magical bartender in America?
America! America!
I will tell
John
you.
John Taffer.
I would say, to be honest, and in all fairness, because I follow like the magic thing, and I don't hang out with magic guys, so I don't, you know, 100%, but...
not since you broke the code in 1994.
As far as what I do, it's in the top 10% of bar guys. I think I definitely could be in the top 10. I'm like bingo at Twitter.
So, like, who
wait,
else?
You mean you're famous based on somebody else's?
No. I'm saying what I do. Is there's only about 10% that do it the way I do it. There's some guys that come in
nobody
and do magic.
Does it the way
no, but
do.
Listen,
no,
you
got to
remember,
it's a niche act.
No, what I'm saying is, what I do is I actually bartend and do magic. What you have is bar magicians that come in and do magic while the bartenders,
all
the bartenders work.
So, what people who do exactly what you do? How many are there?
Probably
international.
Do you know who they are? Do you know one or two?
I know pretty much all of them.
Where?
Las Vegas has like three or four of them.
Okay, forget Las Vegas.
Okay, let's forget Las Vegas. That's a theme of this weekend.
Yeah. Where are we? Let's forget.
So no, but like you know, some bar, like somebody you respect, somebody you think he's
yeah. Well, good. I mean, there's one guy that was Doc Edison. Anyway, he's been doing it forever, and he was the guy who did it at the John Denver's place. The tower, whatever it was, in Denver. Or where is it? Aspen.
All right.
But he worked there forever. Well, he didn't own the bar. When John Denver died, the new owners came in and go, yeah, we don't want you to do it anymore. Get the fuck out. Which could not happen to anyone in this room. Yeah.
That was a Rocky Mountain low.
But he went...
Hey, your boss died, and by the way,
get the fuck out. Yeah.
Clean out your magic locker. Yeah.
Hey, disappear yourself.
Hey, yeah, yeah, your last trick. Get the fuck out.
You've lit up your last feces.
Yeah.
Keep going.
But yeah, again, but the thing about Becker doing bar mat, you get your fucking drink quick.
Oh, yeah.
No, that's
yeah.
It. Not like cocktail.
That's what amazes me in Las Vegas.
He's flipping bottles. And just make me a fucking drink. Becker will give you your drink and then entertain you while you're fucking drinking.
This fucking term, mixologist, or what the fuck?
Here we go. It was horrendous. I couldn't believe it. I mean, when you took the plaid, I go, you guys, you've done a good job remodeling, getting the crowd back. But it was unbelievable. We're at football. There, one guy, he was so sketchy. He'd come up, take one order, and then run off and go take one on there because it's a big round bar. Granted, it's a big bar. But this guy, I don't know if he's disgruntled, if all the staff is disgruntled or what. You couldn't get a fucking drink. I got one guy. I told one guy at the bar on Sunday for football. He was trying to get a Bloody Mary. We had finally gotten service. I got mine. And the guy runs off. He goes, fuck, I wanted a Bloody Mary. And I told the guy, oh, I'm sorry. I would have added yours to my order because I know they don't fucking come back. I go, I'll go to the other bar on the other side of the casino and bring it back for you.
That's right.
And he goes, oh, well, he might come back. I go, what a bet. I ran, and I got him two fucking cocktails from the other bar where the guy was nice and had nobody at it. And he goes, you got it. And every time I walked over there, he'd give me.
You are a magician.
But I did. No, it was the funniest thing ever. That guy was amazed. I set two Bloody Marys down. I go, there you go, sir. And he goes, how much? I go, fuck it. I got it.
I just wanted to be right. It's
yeah.
Not me.
And he was like, the bartender guy starts running over when I set the drinks in front of him. I go, oh, you're here now? Unbelievable. It's Las Vegas. You think of alcohol.
Yeah.
Is your best illusion pouring top shelf vodka? Like, and then it's actually the cheap shit down in the bottom? No?
Wow, that was a fucking nice run we were on.
Oh, wait. Oh, man.
Hey, I was going to say. I think
are we done?
We all fell off the same skateboard there.
I think.
It's a longboard.
I think the problem with the bars out here, well, what we saw yesterday at the sportsbook, video poker fucks it up. Because they have to tend to those people at video poker, and yet we had a slew of people that are just waiting
just
for drinks. And all we can do is squeeze into the service well, where it's one or two people wide.
I've been reliably informed, and this is like the fucking fuel in the fire for Doug, that a lot of the things with Vegas bartenders and casinos is a union thing.
This is the non-union plaza. You know that, right?
I'm not sure about that. I'm not sure about that.
They took union out of the union
they
plaza.
Unplugged the sign when we first came here.
It says Union Plaza on the sign I'm looking at in the room right there.
There you go.
That's the 1960s. From the 60s. Sign, yeah.
It also said something Italian on the license.
But no, and the thing is with Vegas, though, you just assume it's going to be good. And yes, they do have some like carnival court and stuff with amazing flair bartenders. Mm-hmm. You can go on a Sunday and you're like, these guys are amazing. You go, yeah, he's Sunday's show. You should see Friday.
I want to ask Beck, do you watch Bar Rescue? I hate
no,
to ever.
No, I won't. I just, it you makes know, me it's fucking like, do you livid. Watch fucking comedy?
I watch Last Comic Standing because I'm in the business, and right. yeah, I know the bullshit behind right.
but
it.
But his
so,
show is fake. It's not like
yeah, no, he's a fucking biggest piece of shit ever. But it's not it's real. It's one I'm roped into. Bar Rescue. I just Andy and I are both roped in just hating that right. guy. It's no. a form of entertainment.
Right. I used to do that with Nancy Grace.
No, that's a different kind of hate. That's just I want to find you and kill your kids in front of you. That's a. But you're not entertaining me. Anything that's filmed in a bar, we want to watch because we're right. drunks, just right. like Last Comic Standing. I know this is bullshit, but I'm a comedian. I know John Taffer is a fucking fraud, but I'm a drunk, and I like to see things filmed in bars.
Right.
So I just didn't know if you watched
no,
that.
No, I mean, I did. Like I did. Do. But when you're you and you do it like we do, I mean, you go, I pray to God, like the stupid real bar
He's got
owners
such
don't.
A fucking...
Don't actually listen to him because his advice is so ridiculous. He'll take a guy that this guy's stealing money, but hopefully he'll turn his act around and straighten up because the owner's losing his house. And you go, really? You fire him? That's all you do? Good.
He's easy to get on Twitter too. Like they'll put out John Taffer drink recipe. Orange juice and vodka, and then I'll tweet, brilliant, that's why you're my bar hero, John Taffer, and he'll read, you know, whoever retweets it on his behalf. Like, he's such a fucking stooge.
Yeah. But right. he makes a living, you know?
Did you see that?
Go, go.
Did you see what that guy that got tricks Trump to retweet?
Oh, yeah.
It's quite funny.
No.
It's quite, some comic and the comedian whose Twitter handle was like, yeah, fecker. Like, so it should have been a giveaway, but he said to, hey, Donald Trump, my parents just died. You are a huge inspiration to them. here's their picture. And Trump retweeted it. And it's like the UK's most notorious serial killers.
That's why I want to quit comedy, is to go back to being Brendan Walsh funny and just fucking around rather than going, oh, I'm going to save this for the stage. Now let's fucking do weird shit. That's we're going to wrap up the Near the Wild podcast
and
with Matt Becker.
And the Doug Stanhope podcast with Doug Stanhope.
And our special guests, Andy Andrist.
And Brian Hennigan.
And Greg Chaley, as always, on the controls with a special guest appearance by Steve Pogge.
Pogge.
Currently out of the correctional institution.
Out of the system.
But living it up in San Francisco.
Yes.
And now let's either play the Mattoid or what do you like to play?
Turkey in the Straw?
I don't know Turkey in the Straw.
Oh, it's a classic. Look it up.
Fuck, you know what? If we knew those guys, we could, for the Swapcast, if we could do it, for the Swapcast, let's close on...
we should get the Mattoid to do goddamn Turkey in the Straw.
No. Oh, that would be good. That would be good.
No. Don't give the Mattoid any hint of hope. No, otherwise, he'll never leave us alone.
Because you taught me the song. Fuck you. If you want to sue me for playing this, because you turned me onto the song, and Steve Pogge's here, and it's just fitting. Bartender, I really had a good time. Rehab. Broke my parole for the last time. Yes.
All right.
That's already playing.
That's a good one.
Hey. The dirt. She was tripping on the bills. I think she was high on some pills. She threw my shit out into the yard. Then she called me a bum and slapped me real hard. And in my drunken stupor, I did I should have never done. Now I'm sitting here talking to you, drunk and on the run. I'm sitting at a bar on the inside, waiting for my ride on the outside. She stole my heart in the trailer park, so I jacked the keys to her fucking car and crashed that piece of shit, then stepped away. Give me beers till they get here. Yeah, I know the sun is coming up, and y'all are probably getting ready for closing up.
But I'm trying to drown my soul. I'm tired of this life on a dirt road. And everything that I love is gone. And I'm tired of hanging on. She got me sitting at a bar on the inside, waiting for my ride on the outside. She stole my heart in the trailer park. So I jacked the keys to her fucking car and crashed that piece of shit. Then stepped
guess
away.
It was meant to be. Romance is misery, so much for memories. And now I'm headed to the penitentiary. See me on TV, the next cop series. I am a danger. I guess I should have did something about my anger, but I never learned. Real things that don't concern. I pour kerosene on everything I love and watch it burn. I know it's my fault, but I wasn't happy it was over. She threw a fit, so I crashed a piece of shit.
And now
over.
I'm going back again, back to the pen to see my friends. And when we all pile out that county van, they're gonna ask me where I've been. I've been at a bar on the inside, waiting for my ride on the outside. She stole my heart in the trailer park. So I jacked the keys to her fucking car and crashed that piece of shit, then stepped away.